Here we go again. I am Quentin Cooper. This is the FameLab International semi-final part deux with another 10 tip-top national champions from around the world in a brutal battle for a place in the international final. Another three judges primed and ready to ask awkward questions to help them decide who goes through to that final. And another chance for you, yes, you, to help decide what happens in the results because you get to help pick our audience vote winner. Now, if you were at yesterday's first FameLab International semi-final, then welcome back. If you weren't, I heartily recommend you go and see it first because there were some FameLabulous presentations and performances. But if you're determined to press on here first and you aren't entirely sure quite what you're letting yourself in for, then here is what FameLab is all about in far less than 3 minutes. Okay, that should be everyone up to speed. All we need to do now is introduce the judges, say a bit about the audience, and then get straight on with the first of our 10 FameLabulous second semi-final semi-finalists. And the first on that list was judges. I'll get them to introduce themselves. And in no particular order, geneticist Giles Yeo.
Hi, thank you very much for having me. My name is Giles Yeo, and I'm a geneticist from University of Cambridge. My specialty is why people are different sizes, small, medium, large, and the environment we live in. I'm also a broadcaster. I sometimes present some stuff for telly and an author, and I write popular science books. So there we go. Good luck, everybody. And I'm looking forward to this.
Yes, thank you, Giles. And Giles somehow neglected to mention that the highlight of his professional career was appearing in an event at me at the Cheltenham Science Festival on obesity. And no, I was not a test subject, I was the host. Next from Egypt, Nadia El-Awady.
Hi everybody, I'm really, really excited to be with you today. I am a science journalist and editor. I work mainly for two large media organizations. I work for the Springer Nature Group, and I also work for Asia Research News. So I cover a lot of science coming from the regions, from the Arab region, and also from Asia.
And she's also done some amazing things like walking hundreds of miles across into the Arctic Circle and completing an Ironman and cycling across Europe, but Nadia modestly didn't mention any of those. Right, completing our trio with brio, Martin Koth.
Hi, it's great to be back doing FameLab again. And I'm a researcher and a science communicator. At the moment, I'm doing research into climate adaptation with the University of Lapland, but I've done various other things in the past. But I do a lot of science communication work as well.
Oh, sounds like you could have bumped into Nadia while you're up in Lapland. Anyway, now Nadia, each of our FameLabbers is going to be judged on several different criteria, aren't they? They get 3 minutes, but there's also three things you'll be looking out for.
So all of the semi-finalists will know about the three C's. We're talking about content, clarity, and charisma. We need to make sure that the content is factually accurate. That's really important. I need, as a judge and as a listener, I need to be able to have trust in what you're telling me, and I need to be able to go back and fact check it if I can. I also want to make sure that it's simple enough that I understand it as a non-specialist in your field, and I want to be excited about the research or the science that you're communicating to me. I want to be able to listen to the very end and stay concentrated and focused on what you're talking about.
Brilliant, thank you. I mean, Giles, the kind of content, clarity and charisma, they're the kind of XYZ coordinates of FameLab. But all these people, they're already FameLab national champions. They've already got that far. Is there anything extra they're going to need in their DNA to make the evolutionary leap between FameLab International semi-finalist and FameLab International finalist?
I think astute use of eyebrows. No, not really. I do think it is about engaging. And I know that that's part of the charisma, but there is a little je ne sais quoi in terms of engaging the audience. Can you actually engage someone, even if you are speaking about wood lice? And I think that would be something I'd be looking out for.
Ah, we had a brilliant French FameLabber a few years ago who spoke about wood lice, and he was fantastic, and he did make it to the final. Now, Martin, you've been a FameLab finalist. Given that these people are already national champions, what can you tell our semi-finalists that you wish someone had told you just before you went on stage?
Just before I went on stage, I think the most important thing is just to enjoy it. It's very important that when it comes to the engagement, that people can actually see through the performance and see through the content and actually see the person engaging with their own subject behind that. You know, if you're not really having a good time, then you're probably in the wrong place.
Yes, we are going to have a good time and we are in the right place. So judges, thank you in advance for your wisdom, your work and your winnowing down of our 10 national winners to just 5 finalists, and that's 4 + 1 reserve for complicated reasons. Now, I should say, not the entirety of the selection process is going to be down to our judges. One place, our audience vote winner, is going to be down to you. So as you're watching, keep a sense of who you liked best and who you think did the best job. And by best job, I mean best deal of handling the judges' questions and, of course, the presentation itself. Not who had the best outfit, best prop, or even most unusual subject. Rank them in 1, 2, 3 order, and then we'll get on to the voting details later. Okay, judges introduced, check. Rules explained, check. First semi-finalist, check. Well, although he's the Czech champ and considers Prague to be his new home, Josh Smith is actually from North Carolina in somewhere called the United States. I wonder why that doesn't turn up in the news more often. Now, he's been there for 2 years, and when not studying for his PhD at the Institute of Organic Chemistry and Biochemistry, Josh loves exercise in the gym or the great outdoors, hanging out with friends and family. This may be a pre-COVID biog he sent us. And, of course, talking about science, which is how our 2020 FameLab champion for the Czech Republic ended up being Josh Smith.
Too much to do. Can't keep up with everything sometimes. I'm okay. It's just my medicine. And I'm okay right now as well. What I was just trying to illustrate were some of the symptoms of GAD, general anxiety disorder. Things of restlessness or a feeling of a sense on edge. A 2017 report by the World Health Organization reported that 264 million people worldwide are diagnosed with some kind of anxiety disorder, like GAD or OCD. This number, however, does not take into effect that sometimes there's coinciding diseases like depression or societal stigmas that make it hard for people to report or go see a doctor. This number is up 15% from the report 10 years ago. I was also trying to illustrate some of the side effects of benzodiazepines, something like Xanax, a commonly prescribed medicine for the treatment of general anxiety disorders. Despite literature also showing potential risk of abuse, one of the side effects that I was trying to highlight was nodding out, something I've seen many people struggle with on a first hand, unfortunately. Wouldn't it be nice if there was some kind of alternative to this kind of medicine? Maybe there is. What I hold right here is a coconut shell. And this coconut shell holds a drink called kava, a popular cultural Pacific Island drink that in clinical studies have shown to reduce the symptoms of general anxiety disorder. Yet, you don't hear it in pharmaceuticals too often. Why is that? Well, other than possible politics and gatekeeping, the effects, both beneficial and negative, the mechanisms are still relatively unknown. Kava is a cocktail of compounds with a cornucopia of effects, some helping, some hurting. Maybe think of a group project where you have some people doing more work than others and some people doing nothing that's just hurting the project. However, I'm not talking about people, but kava lactones, these little molecules that hold the blueprint or scaffold to one day to become a potential medicine. However, we only have a couple pieces of this puzzle. As I look down to see the other pieces, I see many things that might fit these kava lactones. However, I am almost out of time. I hope to see you next time and tell you how I'm going to use cutting-edge technology like omics to possibly solve this puzzle and hopefully bring you a new medicine one day. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that, Josh. So, let me get this right. So I thought that kava was alcoholic. Maybe I'm mistaken. But when you're actually looking at this coconut, this coconut juice in which you're drinking, how are you actually trying to pull out, therefore, the active compound?
So to start off, kava is not an alcohol. Anything, you should never drink kava with alcohol. One of the effects of one of the kava lactones are that it inhibits P450 cytochrome enzymes and where alcohol is processed. So that's one of the big negative side effects, is that it's usually kava lactones mixed with something else. How we get the kava lactones in the first place? Well, typically we take the rhizome. It's a portion of the plant that's referred to as a modified stem. And they dry the rhizome and they grind it up into a powder. Typical extractions are water extractions. Water extractions tend to leave out the toxic alkaloids that are sometimes present, or the other flavonoids. Other methods of extraction, of course, are typical methanol or acetonitrile or acetone extractions.
The kava isn't the coconut. You've already made that clear, but we weren't quite so clear about what it was. What sort of plant is it? Is it a herb? Is it a shrub?
It's a shrub. I'm sorry. I should have...
So it's not made of coconuts. I thought it was made of coconuts.
No, I'm sorry. I should have made that more clear. The coconut is just how they drink it. I might have... in my mind, it was sensible, but yes, no. The coconut is the container, the vessel... that pertains the kava drink itself. But yes, it is a shrub that uses the dried up rhizome from kava.
And so, Josh, who actually does use this then? And for what purposes? The kava drink?
The kava drink, like I said, it's a cultural drink in the Pacific Islands. It's made its way to Australia, but Australia has put some ban on it. You could bring your own personal consumption amount to Australia. European Union, it varies. They had a ban for it in a while. Germany is one of the larger markets of the kava products. But recently, if I remember correctly, I think in 2015, around there, maybe 2017, can't say a specific date for sure, they reversed some of the ban. In the States, it's currently unregulated, but there is warnings of it to be cautious with how it is used.
And how far is the research on kava lactones progressed?
It's still, I think, in a juvenile state because you have so many of them. You have six major kava lactones that make up 96% of a typical extraction. And there's different literature showing that they inhibit different membrane proteins. Kavavin, one of the major kava lactones, has been shown to potentiate GABA receptors. But this is only one study that hasn't necessarily been replicated. There's been studies that show that it also affects sodium ion channels. Then there's also one study that yanganine, another kava lactone, is an inhibitor of the CB1 receptor. So there's many components present. Also, even though I'm talking about the kava lactones, there are other toxic alkaloids that may be present depending on the extraction method and the part of the plant that is used. So that's where my research is coming in. I don't know if I should go ahead and say or kind of like wait, but what we want to do is hopefully map the cell using the kava lactones.
Okay, I have to leave it there. Judges, it's clear there's a cornucopia of compounds in kava and a cornucopia of compounds in coconut, but they're not the same thing. I also seem to remember kava having some euphoric properties when I tried it in Fiji many years ago, but that is another story. So that is it, check and mate, and that is how FameLab works. They get 3 minutes to share with us a scintillating sliver of science, and then another couple of minutes to deal with the judges' questions and whatever they happen to throw with them. Then we move on to the next finalist, and in this case, or semi-finalist, I should say, it's our champion from Malaysia, Ataleth Don Peris. Now, as regulars will know, I'm quite fond of an anagram, and we've got two corkers coming up. Ataleth Don Peris rearranges to talented trophies and also to this potent leader. How good is that for somebody who's trying to win the world's top science communication competition? Now, Don has a master's degree in oceanography, worked in marine conservation for 2 years, and has now come out on top in FameLab Malaysia. This has all come as something of a surprise to his family, who say that when he was a child, because he talked so much, they thought he'd end up being a comedian. Maybe he has. Maybe he's a talented, trophy-winning, potent leader, and funny too. All I can say for sure is he's from Malaysia, he's here to amaze ya, Ataleth Don Peris.
On December 26, 2004, the Indian Ocean tsunami, with waves more than 20 meters high, had destroyed homes and killed more than 200,000 people across 14 countries, including my home, Malaysia. But as the world mourned to such a devastating disaster, Kapu Henwala, a coastal village in Sri Lanka, was relieved to know that it only had two casualties, as compared to its neighboring coastal village with more than 5,000 death tolls. Sadly, but also intriguing, right? You see, it turns out Kapu Henwala, its coast, was surrounded by this dense mangrove and shrub forest. This mangrove forest, it stops and absorbs the destructive impact of the tsunami waves, sacrificing itself, but protecting everyone behind it, just like Gandalf in The Lord of the Rings when he say, "You shall not pass." Ladies and gentlemen, what the story of Kapu Henwala had demonstrated to the world is the significant role of mangroves when a natural disaster strikes and how saving this forest could help save lives and homes too. In fact, the ecological science behind this is quite interesting. You see, mangrove forest is a unique forest ecosystem mostly found in the tropical and subtropical part of the world along protected coast where freshwater and seawater mixes. Here, the extreme weather patterns and constantly changing in water dynamics made it almost impossible for any terrestrial plant to survive. But mangrove tree species can, because they have the adaptation and tolerance to survive in this harsh environment. For example, some mangrove species have this ultrafiltration ability that allows them to remove salt as the plant takes in water. Even their dense root system function to provide stability as the tree grows over loose, muddy soil. You see adaptation like this that allows them to grow and dominate, forming this dense forest barrier along our coast, which eventually becomes our first line of defense to fight against various natural disasters by absorbing and reducing its impact, saving lives and homes of our coastal communities in the process. But it's not just our homes that mangroves protect, but also the various plant and animal species that lives within it too. And together they form this complex ecosystem where everyone relies on each other and benefit from each other to survive and strive, even us, which is why what we do matters. Through conservation and proper forest management, it is possible to sustain and coexist with nature, connecting your homes and our mangrove forests as a home that provides all and generation to come. Thank you.
Ataleth, what are the main challenges that are facing mangrove forests in that region?
Since most of the mangroves are found in the south, in tropical, include Malaysia, Indonesia, right? Some of the challenges, especially in developing countries, is currently by research is mostly aquaculture. They're converted into aquaculture land for shrimp farm especially. But also another challenge is because most of coastal areas are kind of an attraction for land developers, you see. So So that's another challenge. But also, like the case of Kapuhenwala, right? Even the villagers in Kapuhenwala were not aware that it was the mangrove that saved them. Whereas the neighboring village, they actually have a mangrove early on, but they were basically, there was a lot of deforestation going on. So when the tsunami comes, they were left vulnerable. So it's in terms of individual or community, they were not aware of, but also a lot of aquacultures and also land development that's going on. But we are really seeing a lot of NGOs, publics are really voicing out their opinion. In Malaysia, we're seeing that a lot of happening, which is good. And we also, the countries also involved or states are turning some of the mangrove or wetland area into like a state governed park and so on.
Is there anything we can learn about how the mangroves, you know, can be used as a protective barrier? Is there any way of actually replicating that in a synthetic fashion? In other words, can we actually build, pretend or mangroves in order to protect against something like tsunamis?
As in, how can we replicate it, is it?
Yeah.
The problem, I think it's hard to do that because it's not just the coastal protection, its main function, but also for ecosystem, ecological, right? This mangrove is also a place where a lot of local communities or coastal community relies on, you see, all those fishing activities, timber production. It's not just the ecosystem as a coastal protection, but how the people, especially in developing country, relies on this ecosystem for their livelihood. So it's more on emphasizing the need to protect this mangrove and continue conserving, and also basically how increase awareness among the public itself.
But presumably, there's been quite a lot of mangrove loss. And one of the problems with reforestation is the time that it takes. So is mangrove planting something which is going to produce results within a decade, within 5 decades? What sort of time frame?
Actually, from 1980s to year 2000, approximately like 20% of our mangroves were gone, basically. But as of current, especially after the 2004 tsunami, right, that's where the whole world were like realized that, okay, mangroves really protect. And there's a lot of like massive, intensive replantation, conservation I'm carrying out. So it's not really that bleak, really. It's a slow rate and people are really catching up on it. But of course, in terms of what can be done in this particular issue is that most of the time it's related to balancing between community needs, economy needs, especially environment. So it's all in the middle, really.
Well, we'd love you to swamp us with more information, but we are all out of time for our mangrove man and Malaysian champion, Atalith Don Peris. Now, oceanographically, from Malaysia, it's southeast down the Strait of Malacca, on through the Karimata Strait, then east across the Java Sea and the Banda Sea, then south into the Timor Sea before nipping east again through the Torres Strait, turning south one last time, and then going along the edge of the Coral Sea, and after a couple of thousand kilometres, you'll hit Brisbane, where you should find FameLab Australia winner Cody Freer. Cody is a fifth-year MD, PhD student at the University of Queensland, looking at how to take some of the pain and trauma out of burn injuries, particularly burns injuries to children, and in particular, developing non-invasive ways to speed healing and reduce long-term scarring. We're not doing that. Cody's reading and writing medical history, and we're not doing that. He's playing with Nikolai, his 12-week-old Jack Russell Terrier. Nikolai is apparently very cute. As for Cody, well, you'll have to judge for yourselves. Our 2020 FameLab Australia champion, Cody Freer.
Often it begins with an accident. In Ellie's case, it was a spilled pan of hot oil, causing serious burns to her arms and legs. When I first met her in the Children's Burn Center, she impressed me not only with her resilience, but her in-depth knowledge of the Teletubbies. That's right, this girl could get a PhD in Tinky Winky Dipsy Lala and Poe. While undergoing treatment for her burns, she would reenact the scene from episode 67, a classic, where an ever-growing mass of tubby custard threatens to overwhelm the Teletubbies' home before this guy, their sentient vacuum cleaner, Nunu, swoops in to clean it up and save the day. Actually, the scene was a good analogy for what was going on inside Ellie's burn. Thermal injuries, like custard-related disasters, are highly dynamic. Ones that might at first appear small can grow in severity due to the body's own rogue immune and clotting factors. My PhD focuses on a medical treatment called negative pressure wound therapy, which uses a pump like this to apply a vacuum to the wound environment. Essentially, it's like a nunu for burns in children. The vacuum is hypothesized to improve healing by removing rogue immune cells, decreasing swelling, and directly stimulating the growth of new skin cells and blood vessels. This technology has been widely used in the treatment of other wound types, but it's never been properly studied in the setting of burns. To fill the gap, I performed a clinical trial comparing the current standard of care, antimicrobial dressings, to a combination of standard dressings plus negative pressure. I tracked over 100 children throughout their recovery, and when all was said and done, those with negative pressure fared significantly better. They were 60% less likely to require long-term management, and if given negative pressure within 48 hours of their injury, healed an average of 3 days faster. 3 days. To put that in perspective, you can watch 123 episodes of the Teletubbies in 3 days, which I'm sure a lot of parents have discovered this year. Now, there are technical issues with the apparatus that could be improved, but healing 3 days faster means one fewer painful and expensive dressing change, and more importantly, a reduced risk of permanent scar formation. See, for the almost 11 million people worldwide who sustain a serious burn every year, scarring is a major and potentially life-altering risk. It can affect development and require repeated surgical operations. Which brings me back to Ellie, who didn't receive negative pressure. The last time I saw her, 6 months after her burn, she wasn't pretending to be Nunu. She wasn't playing at all. She was too worried about people seeing her scars. Scars caused by spilled oil and a chaotic biological response that couldn't be controlled. I hope this research helps pave the way for improved burns care and provides a nunu to children like Ellie who don't deserve to bear lifelong scars because of a simple accident.
Thanks very much for that, Cody. That was great. Could you just give us some hint about how this works now that you've established that it does work? Is there anything that you can say in less than a minute about the mechanism of this working?
Absolutely. So negative pressure is known to exert a number of effects on the local wound environment, which broadly fall into four main camps, or as I like to call them, the four S's. So stretch, suck, shield, and stimulate. So it stretches the wound margins closer together because of the vacuum. It sucks wound fluid out of the wound environment. And by removing that fluid, which causes swelling, it reduces compression of the small blood vessels that supply blood to the wound area and are necessary for healing. So if you reduce the compression on those blood vessels, you're improving the flow of nutrients, the flow of oxygen to that tissue that really needs it in order to heal properly. You shield it from the external environment. And while doing that, also maintains a nice humid environment that growing skin cells really like. And then finally, it actually stimulates the growth of new skin cells and new blood vessels by acting on that wound bed. And by exerting these forces on the wound bed, it actually sets off this chemical cascade, resulting in the release of growth factors that increase the production of skin cells, increase the production of blood vessel cells.
Is there a limited size, of wound that this works on? Because you showed the nunu you showed me was not all that large. I mean, can it get bigger so you could do like really quite large burn areas as well?
Yeah, that's a great question. Yes, you absolutely can. In fact, clinicians at the center where I conducted the study have used negative pressure to treat a 70% total body surface area burn. So just for reference, your palm represents a surface area percentage of about 1% of your total body surface area. So multiply that by 70. And the way they did that, that's a great question. You can't just use one device. Now you can use a Y connector to use the same pump for multiple wounds that are located pretty close together. But for that, they actually had to use four pumps, all with their own Y connectors.
And Cody, so
how long? It's interesting that you mentioned the size, actually, because the size of the device was one of the problems that we had in the trial. Young children especially can struggle to mobilize with that pump on, as you can imagine. So what we're doing right now is organizing a follow-up trial involving multiple hospitals and many, many more patients than were involved in my study, and testing these smaller pumps that can actually fit inside your pocket. And so they should be much easier for those younger patients to manage.
Cody, how long does the machine need to be on the wound? And how frequently is it placed on the wound? And then does it hurt?
I wish I knew how long it had to be applied. That's something that we hope to achieve with this follow-up trial. Now, what happened in the trial that I conducted was the patient would present, and then we would apply negative pressure, and the negative pressure would be changed along with the rest of their dressings every 3 to 5 days until they were fully healed. There is some evidence to suggest that negative pressure just applied for the first 6 to 12 hours can actually be as effective as negative pressure applied for days. Now, that was suggested in an animal model study, not in humans. So that's, again, what we hope to figure out with this follow-up study with more patients. Now, in terms of pain, we did collect self-reported and also observational measures of pain from the patients themselves, if they were old enough, their parents or caregivers, as well as the nurses or the clinicians who were involved in the dressing change. And what we found was that actually there was no significant difference between the pain experienced during normal dressing changes and pain experienced during dressing changes with negative pressure. Now, there is some evidence to suggest that the negative pressure can actually decrease pain between dressing changes, but we did not find that in our trial. We found that the pain was essentially the same between treatment groups.
Okay, stretch, suck, shield, stimulate, and of course, stop. Thank you for those 3 minutes of presentation and a couple of minutes of dealing with the judges' questions for our Aussie champion, Cody Freer. Now, over the years, many traditions have developed in FameLab. How FameLabulous everyone is, my overuse of the word FameLabulous, everyone else's overuse of the word passionate, but there is no greater tradition than that the Swiss winner comes from anywhere other than Switzerland. And this exceptional year is no exception. Chemical engineer Shoradeep Majumdar is originally from India, where he worked at Tata Steel Research and Development, but is now doing his PhD at the Federal Institute of Technology in Lausanne. Shoradeep says being in Switzerland, the three things he misses from home are family, food and friends, and the three words to describe himself are simple, inquisitive and compassionate. That's what he does with just three words. Think what he can do with 3 minutes. Our non-Swiss Switzerland champion, Shoradeep Majumdar.
400 ppm, or 400 parts out of a million. This number is considered to be one of the most significant numbers of the 21st century. Remember the forest fires in Australia or the heat waves in Europe? This number is the main reason behind it. So can you guess what I'm talking about? 400 ppm refers to the alarming concentration of this gas molecule carbon dioxide or CO2 in the atmosphere, the primary factor behind climate change. To protect our environment and ourselves, it's therefore important that we capture this CO2 and reduce its concentration. And for that, we need a material that can effectively bind CO2 to its surface, just like a sponge binds water. Or in other words, we need to find a partner that can safely hold CO2 in its arms. But finding a partner for CO2 is complicated, because you see, the CO2 is a very demanding molecule. It has a long list of qualities which it needs in its partner, like stability, capacity, selectivity, etc. Therefore, scientists thought of coming up with a matchmaking process to find the best partner for CO2. Now imagine you're using something like Tinder. Not for humans, but materials. So here we designed a database of thousands of materials, and we tried to include most of the qualities CO2 is looking for, just like Tinder maintains a database of human profiles. Now, a very important part in our relationships is chemistry, right? Similarly here, our next step is to evaluate the chemistry of CO2 with our partner materials. And based on a score, we either accept or reject the material. For example, material 1, how is the chemistry? CO2 does not like it. Swipe left. Material 2, CO2 likes it. There's a strong affinity between CO2 and the atoms of this material. Swipe right. Material 3, wow, CO2 super likes it. Swipe up. And in this way, we shortlist, say, the 5 most promising candidates out of thousands. This entire matchmaking scenario we simulate using computational algorithms. And these simulations make life a lot easier for experimentalists because they can now focus only on these few promising materials and forget about all the remaining thousands, saving years of time and a huge amount of resources. I'm Shaurudi, a researcher in this field, and I would like to leave you with this thought that perhaps matches are made in heaven. But maybe it's time that we make some matches here ourselves to protect our Earth. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that. So just let me be clear. So when you actually find a compound that's able to bind to CO2 and it does its job and actually brings in CO2, what happens to that compound that's bound to CO2? Do we bury it? Do we hide it under a rock? What happens to that compound?
Yes, so this material, once the CO2 binds to it, so our aim is that for this material to be used in a practical industry, we want this CO2, once it's bound to, we also want this material to evoke the CO2 and put this material back to use again. So once we get the captured CO2 out of it, we can then put it underground, like for geological storages, under the rock. Some people also use this CO2 to convert it into some other chemicals or fuels, but ultimately the goal should be that we put it, bury it under the ground, and then we put the material back to use it again, so that this entire process is efficient and we can reuse the material several times.
Shaurudeep, I'm guessing that in your research, you've used this simulation process to find materials that do capture carbon dioxide.
Yes.
So what have you found? What is your research? What are your research findings?
So from my research findings, from this computational screenings, we find some promising for materials which are, we call these metal organic frameworks. These are like these framework like materials which has these holes or pores inside it where the CO2 can trap in. And once we find this promising candidates, we also have our experimental collaborators. We coordinate to them that, okay, so these are the few promising materials, so they can now synthesize only these materials and put it to practice. Because testing a material, synthesizing and evaluating the performance, even for one material, can take several months from an experimental point of view. And to here, so that we satisfy all of CO2's needs, all what its requirements are regarding its attraction and every feature, we simulate these thousands of materials from a computational point of view, and thereby we screen off the process.
Can I just ask for a clarification about what happens to the material? I know you've answered this question already, but what happens to the material after the carbon dioxide has been captured? Did you say that you can use it again? Did you say that you can use it twice?
Yeah. So this process is adsorption. The CO2 gets adsorbed over here on the surface of it. So there's also a process we call desorption. When we release the pressure, the CO2 can also suck up the CO2 out of it. And then we either store it underground or put it to some other use. And then we put this material back to use again. Now, if we have a material which does not evoke the CO2, it keeps it attracted towards itself, then it's again not a good material because we are not being able to reuse it. Our process is not becoming energy efficient in that point of view.
Okay, I'm going to have to stop it there, but I can't believe that when you're talking about a kind of tinder for carbon dioxide capture, nobody's made a joke about carbon dating. Anyway, there ends the Inquisition of the inquisitive, simple and compassionate non-Swiss Switzerland winner, Shaurudeep Majumdar. Now next, it would be very easy and very nice to go with a topical reference when introducing our FameLabber from Kazakhstan, but we're better than that. So instead, I'm going to say that Shokista Ismailajanova is a trainee doctor. She says she's passionate. See, I told you that word keeps turning up in FameLab. She's passionate about a lot of different things, exploring, traveling, medical sciences, outdoor activities, doing work that has a meaningful impact on people's lives. But perhaps her greatest passion is the human brain. Shakista finds it so fascinating and complex, she plans to study for a PhD in neuroscience after completing her medical degree. And she says her goal is to help people protect their brains from Alzheimer's and other nasty neurodegenerative diseases. For the next 3 minutes, though, her focus may be more on expanding our brains than protecting them. Kazakhstan's Shakista Ismail Ajanova.
Every 2 seconds, one, two, somewhere in the world, a person gets a stroke. This often results in a death or causes a disability. When somebody has a stroke, one of the arteries, a blood vessel that supplies our brain with blood and oxygen, gets blocked. This blockage can lead to brain death. How does this happen? Let's say this is an artery, a blood vessel from a healthy person's brain. I want you to appreciate how thin the walls are. Through this vessel, blood can flow without any difficulty. However, when a person is always under stress, has a high blood pressure and high cholesterol levels, these walls tend to change and become narrowed. And now they look more like this. The walls of the artery are covered with a plaque known as atherosclerotic plaque. These plaques pose a huge risk. If they rupture, they can stop blood flow to our brain. So, depending on the affected brain sites, we may experience different symptoms, such as sudden loss of speech, visual changes, or even paralysis. Once the symptoms start, we have a tiny window of time for stroke victims to get a life-saving treatment. This treatment comes in two forms. First, within the first 4 hours, we doctors inject a drug known as TPA, tissue plasminogen activator, to dissolve the plaque and restore blood flow to our brain. Secondly, surgeons can remove the plaque and again help the patients. So now you know that stroke is something serious and can be fatal if not treated urgently. However, I have some good news for you. Recent studies have shown that moderately intense level of exercising and eating a healthier diet rich in fruits and vegetables can, in the long run, lower our risks of having a stroke. Thank you.
Thank you for that talk, Shakista. I have a question about getting urgent treatment to stroke patients. We all know that stroke patients need to get to the hospital as quickly as possible, but it doesn't always happen as quickly as is needed. Is there anything that paramedics can do in the field when they've reached a stroke patient to treat them a little bit more quickly before they get to the hospital?
Okay, thank you for your question. Yes, this tissue plasminogen activator drug that we inject to person's vein, actually they can start that on their way to the hospital, and actually it would be a very excellent job if they started before 4 hours, and that actually really increases the chances of their survival and makes less severe like disabilities for the patient.
Can I ask a question about the sidedness, not the sidedness. So when people have a stroke, sometimes it affects their left side of the body, sometimes it affects their right side of the body, and sometimes it affects their whole body. You know, why does this happen, and is one worse than the other? Is it worse to have it on sided, or is actually have it worse to affect both sides of the brain?
Okay, so yes, our brain, left brain controls our right side, and right brain controls the left side, and that's why, like, depending on the affected brain vessel and which one is blocked, we will have different manifestations. For example, some people in hospital, they can just have only facial like manifestations, clinical symptoms, and so all of these things depend on the exact vessel which is affected. So, this is it.
So, Shakista, what would be your top three? What is it we should be doing, or what is it we should be not doing to protect ourselves from strokes?
Okay, so first thing is some exercising, reducing our sedentary lifestyle and trying to be as active as possible. Even activity up to 30 minutes of walking on the outside, it can actually lower our risks. And second major killer is tobacco and alcohol consumption. Alcohol as well as smoking, they double the risks of some people having a stroke. And third thing is, of course, our diet, weight control. And studies have shown that obese people are more likely to have stroke because they will have more cholesterol in their blood vessels, and that actually eventually increases our risks. So these three, maybe four, habits, I'm speaking of all bad habits together, and that's it.
Thank you, judges. Out of time. And we should say for the record that Shakista especially deserves a Kazakh-standing ovation because she was runner-up in the Kazakhstan final. And only earlier today, we heard that the winner had to pull out of participating, unfortunately. So Shakista has come in at literally only a couple of hours' notice, which is why we used that pre-recorded video before she was talking to the judges live. Right, we're now halfway through our second semi-final, which means three quarters of the way through both semi-finals, which means we've seen a lot of FameLabulous presentations already, and there's only five more to go. And next we come to one of our newest country champions. They only held their finals last week, and that country is Brazil, and that newly crowned champion is Gabriela Ramos Leal. Now, despite Gabriela Ramos Leal being an anagram of "I am a real large slob," I bet she isn't. I'd also bet she's a vet. Well, sort of. After getting her veterinary medicine degree, Gabriela is now a professor at Castelo Branco University in Rio, but she specializes in veterinary embryology. So that may not make her a typical vet, but I definitely think she's one who can answer the old riddle, which came first, the chicken or the egg. Get braced for some Brazilian brilliance from their reigning champion, Gabriela Ramos Leal.
Since I was a kid, I have been in love with the Disney princess movies. And between all that magic, my favorite part was the animals. Have you seen that all the animals have some kind of special talents on these movies? The birds can fly and clean the house. The mouse from Cinderella can make a dress to her to go to the ball. Abu from Aladdin gets food to ensure the survival. It is amazing. But the thing is that animals are also amazing in real life. And I know that now you might be thinking, oh, okay, the animals are cool and they are cute, but they don't have special talents like in the movies. But what if I told you that some of them do? A special talent, some kind of power that, like in the movies, aims to help people. Well, these animals exist, and they are known as bioreactors. And the bioreactor animals also have a special talent, a feature that makes them different from other animals. For example, there are cows able to produce human insulin in their milk. Yes, the insulin that a diabetic person eats, that is right. The scientists have discovered that it is possible to take the gene responsible for insulin production in human and put inside the cow's DNA, creating a genetically modified animal. A bioreactor, an animal that can produce a substance that normally it couldn't produce. A super animal, an animal that can even save your life. And nowadays we have cows and goats and sheep and pigs able to produce some kinds of human substance like insulin, the growth hormone, the coating factor, among others. But this has a reason. All these substances are therapeutic. They are produced in the animals to treat human health problems. You know, Brazil, my country, is one of the main consumers of medicines in the whole world. And the use of our bioreactor animals is a way to produce a safe medicine and make it more affordable to the population. It sounds like Disney magic, I know, but it is science, because the animals are really amazing. And maybe they don't make dresses or turn into pumpkins for real, but in the real life, they are able to produce whatever is necessary just to save you. Thank you.
Gabriella, that was great. Thank you very much for that. So can you give us, you gave us one example of insulin. Could you give us just maybe one or two others of bioreactor compounds which are actually in use?
Okay, there are also the growth hormone, the coating factor. There is interesting research with pigs and the coating factor, and other substances like trypsin or immunoglobulin and something like that, you know. And there are several animals that are tested to know how fluid works better to produce this kind of substance. Like we can use milk and urine and blood, but they realize that milk is a good fluid to work with this substance.
So that is very fascinating, but just to clarify, so insulin, for example, is only produced in the pancreas normally. So if you're making a bioreactor car, for example, where do you put the insulin gene? I mean, you said it's produced from the milk. Does it mean you put it into the mammary glands of the cow?
So first of all, I need to say that transgenic animals as a bioreactors is an interesting thing. So I wanted to bring this to FameLab. But I work with embryo in vitro production. That is a basis for clones and for transgenic animals. But we start in the beginning, so there are some ways to create a transgenic animal. We can do microinjections in the pronucleus on the fertilization. We can use like nuclear transfer. We can use also a virus to do the transfer genetic. And we can also use some spermatozoons that are modified first. But they have I don't know if I know how to say this in English, but there is a promoter that is used to recognize the tissue, the specific tissue, to be produced the substance that people wanted to be produced.
Gabriella, you said that this was a safe way to produce insulin. What is the evidence that shows that this is safe?
Okay. Yeah, so we actually have animals that also that already produced some kind of substance, but there are many steps after that to become this really, you know, touchable to the population, because we already have animals producing other substances, but we don't have this, you know, so easy for a person to go to a place and buy a medicine made by an animal. This is not a reality, but is a reality that we already have animals producing this substance. But of course that we need to look to these animals, we need to check the impact of this in the animal health, and we need to separate the fluids and isolate the substance and do very other process to make this viable to the population. So there is several steps between you have an animal, you have this animal, and you see if this animal is capable of transmit this gene to the next generation, and you see if there is some impact in the animal health. So there are very and many steps before it can be, you know, distributed to the population.
Thank you, judges. Lots of insulin insights and super stuff on super animals there from our newly crowned Brazilian champion, Gabriela Ramos Leal, which is also an anagram of rare global malaise, which seems a pretty appropriate description of the planet right now. Six down, four to go. Sophia, so good. And next we get to the general area of Bulgaria, and from their high performance computing lab, we have their high performance winner, Ivo Iliev. Ivo is also in the final year of his PhD in theoretical physics at Sofia University, where his big brain, both spellings of brain, is deeply entangled in string theory. Now that might make him sound a little bit one-dimensional, but Ivo can talk about all sorts of other matters, or antimatters. Just be careful if he does both, because... Anyway, he may be a theoretical physicist appearing in a virtual FameLab semi-final, but he's in with a real chance. 2020 FameLab Bulgaria champion, Ivo Iliev.
We might think of science as something cold and calculated, but in reality it's full of little quirks. It's made by humans after all. And this is nowhere more clear than in scientific conventions. A quick example. In electricity, we say that the electric current moves from the positive to the negative side of the battery. But in reality, later we found out it was negative force carriers. It was the electrons that carry electricity. So even to this day, students in school are stuck with learning that for some reason the electric charge moves in the opposite direction to the force carriers. And don't even start me about biology. Just after this, look up what is a mountain chicken. You'll be amazed. But the quirk I really want to talk about today is not only historical, but it comes from geography and astronomy as well. I want to talk about angles and clocks. First, how do we measure angles? Well, imagine I throw a ball. Well, my hand and the horizon form an angle. We can measure this angle the long way around, but it really makes sense to measure it the short way around. And this gives us a natural sense of rotation. And we call this rotation anti-clockwise. But why, if we have this natural sense of rotation, did we choose another convention for the hands of the clock? Well, it all comes from the clock's predecessor, the sundial. First, clocks were firstly created with hands in the Northern Hemisphere. In the Northern Hemisphere, the sun, it starts its daily journey from the east, goes southwards, and then sets in the west. The sundial, which is just a pole in the ground, casts its shadows firstly in the west, then northwards, and then to the east, forming this sense of rotation that later clockmakers called clockwise. But it could have been different if we had if Earth was such that clocks were created firstly in the southern hemisphere, where the rotation of the sundial is reversed, we would have lived in a slightly different world. And actually, because my left is your right, you managed to experience this world for a bit, because just for a minute, you lived in a world where the clock moves backwards. Science, like my talk, could be a little bit messy, but really boggles the mind that there is a hypothetical Earth in which clocks moved in a different direction because they were created in the southern hemisphere, and our choices of notation were just a little bit clock wiser. Thank you very much.
That is amazing. I did not know that, Ivo. That is, I'm gonna, at the Christmas table, that's gonna be my trivial fact now. So what else? I mean, what other examples do you have to boggle? Come on, you gotta have a couple just to share with the audience.
Oh, you can actually talk about angles, because I'm saying that we measure angles like this, but it's only because in most European languages we write from the left to the right. Otherwise, we could make the positive axis right to the left, not to the right. So even in that case, we have a weird convention. And there's a lot of things that come from history. For example, in string theory, the string tension is... this is a very complicated example, but it's tied to something that's called the Regge slope, which has nothing to do with string theory. It just comes from historical conventions. So science is full of these things.
Ivo, you asked us to look up, was it mountain chicken? Did I hear you right when you said to look?
Yes, mountain chicken.
You're going to have to tell us what mountain chicken is.
It's a frog. It's a type of frog. Apparently it tastes like chicken. That's the reason.
So would you like to, I mean, this is something which is very interesting to me. I'm just interested in what you think. This conception that science is somehow... exists on an inhuman level. Do you think that this is one of the problems that people have when they come to science for the first time? Do they not get the fact that it's essentially human?
Yes, I think that's correct. Actually, a lot of people believe that science is something beyond us, but it is humanity trying to understand its place in the universe. And That is what science is about. It's not about physics, it's not about biology, because these are just labels that we put on science. Like, knowledge is knowledge. It could be biological, it could be physical, it could be something that comes from, for example, philosophy, but that still could be like valid knowledge and valid reasoning about our place in the universe.
Thank you, judges. Yes, the mountain chicken is a Caribbean frog, I think. I think it's from Montserrat or somewhere like that. And yes, I've heard that it does apparently taste like chicken. Right, that was sinister stuff with clocks going backwards. But if the clocks go backwards, will Evo go forwards to the final? We will find out soon enough. Also, I should say, 8 letters and 2 Vs, so no chance of me doing any anagrams of Evo Iliev. And the next contestant, spookily, is 8 in terms of position and exactly twice 8, 16 in terms of numbers of letters in his name. Alejandro Sanchez is the FameLabber who currently reigns in Spain. He's from Alicante. He's an aerospace and satellite navigation engineer, and he's based at the École Nationale de la Aviation Civile, which, as you'll have figured out from the sound, is not in Spain, it's in France. So we're not finding his way from Spain to France by ground or air. Alejandro is, well, he's all over the place. He says he does a lot of different things, including sports, dancing, traveling, which he really misses at the moment, and public speaking. Well, we may not get to see him doing anything sporty or travel-y or dancey, but the public speaking is coming up right now. From our Spain lab, our Fame Lab Spain campeón, Alejandro Sanchez.
Okay, I need you to be very creative right now. Imagine you are at your favorite pub, enjoying and fueling your scientific skills with a pint of beer as if no pandemic existed. As you leave your elbow for a little too long, you decide it's time to set your course back home. As you start walking, the roads suddenly look like a raging sea. The sky spins uncontrollably, and your navigation skills are lost. Moments before disaster, you have a brilliant idea. Take out your phone, press a button, and bingo, the GPS is activated. Easy, right? In fact, it is not. Something as simple as knowing your position is the product of one of the most complex systems we have nowadays. The American GPS is a set of ground stations, satellites, and users which belongs to the group of Global Navigation Satellite Systems, or simply GNSS. There are other GNSS systems, the European Galileo, the Chinese Beidou, or the one your mom uses to find anything around the house, but we don't know much about that one. The GPS system does not tell you your position. Instead, the satellites pick up information coming from the ground stations and send it by means of electromagnetic signals which arrive to our phones. With this data, our phones are able to compute the position of the satellites and obtain the time at which the message was sent. To compute this time, we cannot rely on our smartphones' cheap clocks. Instead, satellites have atomic clocks, which are able to compute the time without making a single mistake for millions of years. Some researchers even compare these clocks to the Queen of England, because they are able to do their job very well for a very, very, very long time. Knowing the emission and reception time of the signal, and since it travels at the speed of the light because it is an electromagnetic wave, we can compute the distances from our phone to the satellites, and with all of them obtain our position. This process is known as trilateration. Now, the position of any object on the Earth can be expressed by means of 3 coordinates. Flat Earthers, be careful, because here is where you get lost. And our smartphone's clock, which we should remember is not very good, must be corrected too. So at the end we have 4 unknowns or parameters to solve. This is why we need a minimum of 4 satellites with their 4 distances, that is, 4 equations, in order to solve our position and correct our clock. As we can see, satellite navigation is pretty complex, and it goes unnoticed in our daily lives, although it is the center of many basic services. Air navigation, goods transportation, our matches on Tinder. So remember, next time you drink a little too much, you will be one button away from knowing your position. And lucky for us, it is that simple.
Alejandro, we all use the GPS systems on our phones these days. What should we be expecting in the future?
Well, in the future, the first thing we should expect is a higher increase in the precision of these devices, not only in integrity-related applications where safety is concerned, but for everyone else, in your smartphone you should be able to achieve centimetric precision, which would allow you to, for example, navigate a car or navigate through a building with only your smartphone. Paired with this, or combined with this advancement, we should also expect more hybridization, which is a combination of your GPS signal with other sensors, like an accelerometer or a gyrometer, in order to obtain better precision.
So it's always four satellites that you need. So three for the trilateration, one for the time. Do you ever use more? Does more give you more precision in any way?
Well, actually, normally you use many more than four satellites. To have an idea, you roughly get around 10 to 12 satellites in a normal open sky or in the middle of the city. So this allows to actually have better precision. Why? Because you will be getting some satellites from a lower elevation, and that will mean a set of additional problems like longer propagation times, so reflections on the buildings, while you will also get some satellites coming from the zenith, where the propagation time will be better, since it will be subjected to less propagation mistakes. So overall, we get around 12 satellites, which is many more than the ones we need for the minimum we need to compute our position.
I'd just like to explore the possibility that we're building our entire civilization, our entire technological reliance on these things, which do seem to me to be very fragile, things like solar flares and so on and so forth. What do you think are the pros and cons of us relying on these systems?
Yes, well, as you mentioned, there are many things that could affect the GPS and the other GNSS systems, and we don't even need to refer to other events, as you mentioned, like solar flares, which might be less common. But mainly there are some devices which are able to spoof or to jam these signals. So mainly the problems come from our own planet. Due to these devices and these situations where the signal is attacked, there are many other applications which are being combined or are being paired with the GPS in order to take the advantages from the GPS or from Galileo, from the GNSS, which is the global coverage, and the fact that it's widely spread, with these other applications, like, for example, the fact of having an accelerometer or a gyrometer, which we all have on our phones, for example, which cannot be jammed or cannot be attacked. So there's also a lot of work going on protecting these signals and having alternatives. So for the moment, it's actually pretty safe. We can still rely on GPS.
Out of time, but so many things we could pick up on there. The Carrington effect and solar flares and how that affects our ability to navigate. Whether or not, if everybody depends on sat-nav, we've lost the ability to actually read maps. And of course, what should happen to a country that was part of, say, the Galileo project and then suddenly stopped being part of Europe? Would everybody then get lost? No need then to beware our Spaniard with the gift of bearings, Alejandro Sanchez. Now, we've already had something of a animal's leitmotif to this semi-final. We've had Gabriella, our sort of vet from Brazil, Cody, our Aussie with a very cute Jack Russell, and now we've multiple dogs and a single kata from Hungary. Now, I don't mean single in the sense of marital status, I mean there's only one kata, Vikonya, and although she started out studying electrical engineering, after adopting a dog, she's become fascinated by their behaviour and their relationships with other dogs and with humans. Having completed her master's research into canine reward sensitivity, she's now doing a PhD investigating the social dynamics of cohabiting family dogs and its implications for their lives. Kata is clearly very fond of dogs because when not studying them, she's worked as a care technician at an animal shelter. She's co-founded an online platform to help Hungarian dog lovers become more involved with canine research. And she's also a board member of an animal rescue foundation. Every dog has his day, but not every dog has his kata. Our last but one semi-finalist, Kata Vikonya.
I think we can agree that to hit on the head with an axe, then hiding under a bush for 2 days between life and death would qualify as trauma. This is not some hypothetical scenario. This is exactly what happened to my dog Abrand before I adopted him. It was 2 years ago, and now he seems pretty normal, and he's cute. The only thing you may notice is a small difference between the 2 ears. Oh, and his PTSD. In humans, trauma-linked psychological problems are well studied and handled under the term post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD. This condition comes with a wide variety of symptoms, including hypersensitivity to stressors, hyperarousal, sleeping disorders, just to name a few. Abrand is usually hypervigilant and aroused. It's hard for him to calm down and settle when I'm not around as a safe base. The US Army officially recognizes canine PTSD as a diagnosis since 2010, and it affects around 10% of war veteran dogs. Interestingly, it's a similar ratio that we find among war veteran humans. The most famous case was Gina, a dog of war who served 6 months in Iraq, but due to repeated exposure to flash grenades, she wasn't herself anymore when she returned. She became skittish and fearful. She even refused to enter buildings to flush out enemy during trainings. It's pretty similar to human patients who relive their trauma upon encountering triggers so they avoid anything that reminds them of the traumatic event. Still, canine PTSD is highly under-researched. Only a handful of studies even mention the consequences of trauma in dogs, usually handling trauma as a risk factor in the development of certain behavioral problems such as aggression and fearfulness. This is not only a pity because lack of research means lack of proven treatment options for dogs, it also deprives us from understanding the human condition better. Animal models currently used in PTSD research rely on laboratory rodents exposed to predators to induce trauma. But dogs of war, who inevitably face trauma at some point, and dogs rescued from abuse like Abrand, could be better, more lifelike models of the human condition than some lab rats traumatized by cat memes. So, who knows? Maybe by helping our best friends, we could learn how to help ourselves too. Thank you.
Kata, thank you very much for that. Can you give us just one example? Are there any examples of treatments which have been shown to be effective in humans which are transferable in any way to animals?
It's a very tricky question because there is completely zero research on treatment effectivity on dogs. They tried some human medications and there are anecdotal reports of its helping. But mostly what is used in the case of dogs is behavioral therapy.
Kata, I want to ask you, these days here in the UK where I live, there are a lot of fireworks going on, and there are dogs or and other pets and animals and young children who get anxious when they hear the fireworks outside. Is there a way to desensitize animals from that kind of an anxiety?
It's one of the favorite questions of any ethologist, and if it was a radio interview, I would say that turn to a dog trainer. But as I'm also working with animals outside of the lab, I can answer. Usually desensitization with playing thunderstorm sounds on a speaker, first very low volume and then turning the volume higher, usually helps, but not with every dog. In case of thunderstorm, there's also the air pressure and different smells and electric stuff going on that can make a dog anxious. But desensitization as a first step is very good. There are also some medical treatments that can be used, even over-the-counter medications for dogs, and pheromone therapy, and also thunder shirts, which are very tight on the chest of the dog. And if it's only put on the dog for 10 to 15 minutes, it can really help to ease the pressure on the dog.
Kata, that was fantastic. So one of the treatments, the non-pharmaceutical treatments of PTSD is like you can use cognitive behavioral therapy, certainly in humans. Is there any evidence or has anyone, is it possible to do cognitive behavioral therapy in dogs?
That's a good question. Of course, there is no evidence. As I said, there is no research on treatment of dogs. What we use in dog training currently in the therapy of dogs with PTSD, or let's say dogs exhibiting PTSD-like symptoms, because only the US Army recognizes canine PTSD. So it's not a worldwide thing that that vets recognizing PTSD as a diagnosis in dogs. We usually use a lot of desensitization. We use a lot of generalization, so small stimuli, specific stimuli that's not reminding the dog to the trauma, but something related, and then generalize the positive associations to other things.
Almost like a vaccination.
I never thought about it this way, but yeah, there's something like that, yeah.
That's great. Judges giving you ideas as well as you giving our judges ideas. That was Kata Vekoni. And just in case you are wondering, there are 9 widely acknowledged breeds of Hungarian dog, and they are the Puli, Pumi, Komondor, Kuvas, Mudi, Vishla, Wire-haired Vishla, Hungarian Greyhound, and the Transylvanian Hound. And Abran is apparently a bit of all of them because he's a super mongrel. Right, finally, or semi-finally, we've got our 2020 FameLab Ireland winner, Simon Spishak. Now, as you might be able to tell from his name, Simon isn't originally from Ireland. He's from Canada. And slightly maintaining our animal theme, he's very fond of raccoons and birds, but he's also fond of coffee and brains, particularly brains. Simon is a neuroscientist and moved to Ireland to do research at University College Cork on the gut microbiota brain axis and how communities of microorganisms lurking in our digestive tracts are able to send signals to our brain. It is a really fascinating subject and one I hope he's going to be talking about today, but this being FameLab, as long as he's under 180 seconds and scientifically sound, he can pick whatever he likes. A big finish, please, from the 20th of our 2020 FameLab International semi-finalists, Simon Spishak.
What is smart? Or better yet, why is smart? How are all of my fellow FameLab contestants so intelligent? We might first think about the brain, the big thing that's inside of our heads, right? So our brain is full of these exciting brain cells called neurons that communicate with each other to coordinate everything we do in a central area. And it evolved this way in part because our ancestors needed to figure out efficient ways to remember where food is, as well as remembering complex social relationships. So it would be really awkward living with someone if you always forgot their name, right? That's why I had my housemate's name tattooed on my arm. Helps me remember. Now, anyways, you might think that you need a centralized brain kind of system, as well as a need for remembering stuff about others or the social interaction aspect in order to stew together an intelligent creature. But that's where you're wrong. Say hello to my little friend. This is an octopus. There are over 280 species of octopus living in our oceans right now. They are incredible, and they basically throw everything we know about how intelligence and brains develop, they throw it all away. So what really happens with octopus is that they have 9 brains. Not 1, not 2, not 3, but 9 brains, right? So they have a brain in each tentacle, and they also have one in their head. And having 9 brains sounds complicated, but octopus make it look so, so easy. So an octopus can even decide to use half of its tentacles to flirt with a nice looking octopus, hubba hubba, and the other half to fight off a rival. Now, the other really cool thing about octopus is that they can think ahead. So they grab a coconut shell as they're going out for food so that they can cover up in case they see a predator, which is absolutely incredible. And what else is they can coordinate to change their shape, texture, and color on a whim, even though all of their brains are located in different areas. Right? And that is a sign of something that's truly intelligent in a way that we aren't. I mean, I've been trying all morning to camouflage myself, and it hasn't been working. Anyways, learning about the octopus teaches us about how wonderful all of these animals in nature are, and we can use their nervous system to learn about the best ways to design robots, as well as how to design computer algorithms that can help us understand the world better and more efficiently. Thank you. This has been a message from our octopus overlords.
Thank you so much, Simon. So while you say that an octopus has 9 brains, I mean, does, however, the brain in the head of the octopus, such as it is, I mean, does it control the other 8, you know, the 8 in the tentacles, or are they actually independent of each other?
What's really amazing is that they can act independently or together. So if one arm senses something, because they also have smell receptors on their tentacles, it can immediately react and it can initiate a motor response. So it can feel something and immediately coordinate a response without sending a message to the brain in the head. Whereas the brain in the head can also coordinate kind of large-scale behaviors.
Simon, are there other organisms that have more than one brain?
So the octopus come from a very cool family of animals called cephalopods, and they all have kind of a diffuse nervous system. And they're also considered fairly intelligent. They can do a lot of similar things. We also have animals like the jellyfish, which are basically a bunch of nerves just hanging out in the ocean, and they don't really have a centralized brain. And more incredibly, there's also something called a slime mold. It's a piece of slime, right? But it can actually navigate and find the most efficient pathways to find food. It doesn't have a brain. It just sort of leaves a slime trail for itself to kind of go, okay, I should turn left here. So there's a lot we don't really know yet about cognition and what's kind of necessary in terms of how many brains you need to have.
I'd just like to say that if you're a human being and you want to have 2 arms fighting off an enemy and another 2 arms doing some flirting, then you just need more than one person. I mean, we can have 9 brains if we have 9 people and we form a collaboration. Is there any evidence that octopuses work together in units of larger than 9, i.e. put 2 octopuses together and have 18 brains working?
Oh God, no. The octopus is very introverted. There's a few species that like to hang out in threes. But for example, there was one study where they got an octopus to be social by giving it a party drug, ecstasy. Otherwise, octopus tend to cannibalize each other, and their parents die before they're born. So it's incredible that they do all of these things without having someone to learn from.
Now, as you may recall, if you were here yesterday, taking advantage of our new fabulous online incarnation, rather than the judges rushing off to deliver an incredibly swift verdict, they have as much time as they need, and we will not reveal their decision alongside whatever the judges in yesterday's semi-final decided until next Monday. That's the 16th of November at high noon. So make a note of that in your diary. 16th November, noon GMT. That is when we will have all our results on this same YouTube channel. At that exact same time, we will unveil the 2 FameLabbers, one from each semi-final, who get to go through as the audience vote winners. Now, obviously, the people watching yesterday have chosen one, and now comes the time for you watching today to choose the other, okay? So, your screen should now just have multiple options popping up for how you vote. You can follow the link now appearing in the chat box, or scan the QR code, or go to FameLab or Twitter and use the link there to vote. Whichever path you take, all you have to do is pick your three favorite FameLabbers based on their presentation and how they dealt with the judges' questions. Then rank those three as your first, second, and yes, you're way ahead of me, third choice. Those votes from everyone will then be fed into the FameLab supercomputer, and if we crank it up properly, it will calculate who will get through to the final as the audience vote winner. Now, if that all makes sense, great. If it doesn't, well, you'll probably figure it out by trial and error. And if it still doesn't, well, hey, congratulations, you've been disenfranchised. Go and join many people in the United States. No, maybe not then. Now, voting is open now, this very, very second, right now. You have 24 hours, no more, in which to make up your mind and put your mark down. But we recommend doing it now because that's where this semi-final finishes. Thanks to everyone who's made it possible, our FameLabulous FameLab champions from around the world, our judges, our behind the scenes team, and of course, all of you, wherever you are around the world, whatever time of day you're watching this. I hope you're going to be back to discover the full lineup for the international final by joining us back here on Monday, the 16th of November at noon GMT. And we'll leave you with a little reminder of who you've just seen and how you can vote for your favourites. Ta-ra!